Genesis chapter 11. We're going to be in chapter 12 today and into 13, but we're going to get a running start into those chapters. And if you would also like to hold your place in Isaiah 30, Isaiah 30, we'll be over there a couple of times, and 31. And so you can get your church bulletin and place it in Isaiah 30. And or a bookmark or whatever you might have handy. Well, we have been studying and going through verse by verse, chapter by chapter through Genesis for the past couple months, several months, and we have been learning about how these historical accounts of God and His creation and His plan for the world and now into the life of Abraham affect us and how we can apply those things. Over in Romans chapter 15, verse 4, it says, "For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction." In other words, these historical accounts that we read about in the Word of God apply to our lives just as much as they applied then, they apply now. And in fact, in Romans 4 as well, in Romans, it says in chapter 4, verse 16, it says, "Abraham is the father of all who believe." And so we see some lessons, and we'll see certainly today some things we can learn from Abraham's life. To recap a little bit, again, to get a running start into our study for today, a little bit about what has been going on with Abraham's call. He's currently called Abram. He'll later be called Abraham. Not quite yet. God's going to change his name, as we looked at last week, from Abram, exalted father, or meaning honorable leader, even it could be interpreted that way, to father of a multitude. And he was named father of a multitude before he had any children. And so God gave him that name, and Abraham walked in that promise after God named him that, and later saw the promise fulfilled. So we looked at that last week. So let's go back a little bit into chapter 11 and verse 27 and just have a recap a little bit of where Abram came from. It says, "Now these are the records of the generations of Terah. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot." So Terah, Abram's dad, had three sons. And then he also mentioned Lot because he'll be significant in the story. "And Haran died in the presence of his father, Terah, in the land of his birth, in Ur of the Chaldeans. And Abram and Nahor took wives for themselves. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah, the daughter of Haran, and the father of Milcah and Iscah. Now Sarai was barren, she had no child. And Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went out together from Ur of the Chaldeans in order to enter the land of Canaan, and they went as far as Haran and settled there. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran." And so we see that back in Ur, and we learned again, a recap, that Ur was a place of idol worship. In fact, Ur was known for worshiping the moon god. In fact, the center of moon worship was in Ur. And in fact, they had a symbol. It was a crescent moon that they would used and they found in archaeological digs and all that in Ur. And Ur was in modern day Iraq. And so in modern day Iraq, is there another religion over there that has a crescent moon as one of its symbols? Absolutely. And we'll talk later, not today, but later in Genesis, about that connection as well. And so we see Abram is called, and we also looked at how from Acts, we learned that Stephen, when he was preaching to the Pharisees before they stoned him to death, that he said that Abram was called while in Ur. And what we see in chapter 12 was the second calling of him. And he was called while there. God called him from idolatry, it says over there. And so here, Abram's been called out. He is the father of faith who's been called from paganism. And just very interesting, because there were many others. Abram knew Seth. He knew Noah, actually. In fact, Shem. He knew Shem. Shem lived almost the whole lifespan of Abram himself. And so it's just interesting that there were these other believers around, and yet Abram's family were idol worshipers, yet God called him, because God knows the future. God knows a person's heart. He knows how they're going to follow in faith. Saying all that to set the stage that Abram has yet to arrive. He's the father of faith now. He was not very faith-filled then, and he had plenty of human mistakes. And again, that's why I love studying these Old Testament characters and other characters, even in the New Testament, throughout the Word, because we can relate to their challenges to their faith, and even their failures we can relate to. So Abram, the father of faith, again, didn't start out that way, but here's the good news. God does not give up on him. And by the way, he's not going to give up on you and me either. Even though we fail, he's not going to give up on us. He allows us to go through circumstances and challenges to our faith so that we grow in faith, not that we give up, because he's not going to give up on us. So that's the good news I want to start out with, because we, like Abraham, definitely blow it from time to time. Have any of y'all thought maybe by this time in your walk with God that you'd be farther along than you are now? All of us feel that way. All of us can relate to that. And Abram perhaps felt that same way. He's very relatable to us. So let's get into chapter 12 and let's see. Oh, before we do that, I want to mention something in verses 31 and 32. It says, Terah took Abram his son and all this. So Abram's called, but Terah leads. Did you notice that? Abram's the one who's called, but he's letting dad lead him to a place, not necessarily where they were led to go, and settle in Haran. It says at the end of verse 31, they settled there. Well, we know from doing the math and the years and adding it all up, they were there about 25 years. So he left around age 50 from Ur, went to Haran, and he was there till about 75 years old. And it says, in the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. So here's what I want you to notice. God doesn't throw up his hands and say, Abram, I called you and you're delaying. In fact, we looked at how the name of the place and even Terah's name means delay. And Haran means parched. And they're in this parched, dry land and they're being delayed. And all of a sudden, God says, I got you, Abraham. I got you, Abram. I'm still with you. God's not mad at him. In fact, he's waiting and watching and allowing Abram to go through these things so that he grows. So if I mentioned Isaiah chapter 30. If you look over at Isaiah chapter 30, this gives us some insight into the character of God and how he treats Abram and how he treats you and me. Look at verse 18 in Isaiah 30. It says, therefore, the Lord longs to be gracious to you, and therefore he waits on high to have compassion on you. The word for compassion there, how many in your Bible have the word mercy in Isaiah 30 verse 18? You may have mercy there, same word. For the Lord is a God of justice. How blessed are all those who long for him. God, I picture, is sitting on the edge of his seat. He wants to hear from us, and he's waiting to show us compassion and mercy and grace. So we see here, God is not mad at him. He's simply waiting for Abraham to come around. So he approaches Abram once again. Now that Terah has died, he can move along and get on into the calling that he's called him to. So look what it says in chapter 12. Now the Lord had said to Abram, we mentioned that in some translations it says the Lord said, and some it says had said. I think had said is a better translation because he's repeating it. Had said to Abram, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you. Now I want you to note how many times in this first three verses it says, I will. We've seen it once in verse 1 and then in verse 2. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. And you can imply there, and I will make your name great, right? Because that also applies to the previous phrase. And so you shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. That's an amazing promise. That's one that even today we see. Nations throughout history that have come against Israel have fallen. America, when she blesses Israel, thrives. When America turns her back, which she hasn't fully turned her back on Israel at this point, if she were to, it's going to be trouble for America. That promise is timeless, and it still holds. Look at history, and you see the nations around Israel who've come against Israel have soon thereafter fallen. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. Now, before we get into that particular, looking at those first three verses again in a little more detail and then making our way through chapter 12, I want to mention a song, and we're actually going to do this at the end of the service today. It's the song, Yes, I Will. So God says, I will, I will, I will, all through those first three verses. What's our part? Well, the song, Yes, I Will, says this. I'm going to read some of the lyrics. It says, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. In the waiting, and this is what we're talking about here, God's waiting on Abram just as much as Abram's waiting on God. We really see God waiting on him. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. I will bless your name. I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. And then it goes in, he says, it goes into the chorus. So what's our job while God is fulfilling his promise and all these things? Well, our job is to lift him high in the lowest valley, to bless his name, to sing for joy when our heart is heavy. And so we have a job too. While God is doing his part, our part is to count on him and trust in him and grow in that faith. So Abram has left the nation. But again, Abram heard God saying, follow me. But instead he followed family and he followed his dad. And his dad wasn't really seeking the Lord. His dad wasn't the one who had the call. And God doesn't speak again to Abram 25 years later until that relationship ends. When that relationship ends, again, 25 years, the Lord spoke. That's why, again, Isaiah 30:18, the Lord will wait that he may be gracious to you, that he may be exalted, that he may have mercy on you. So how do we apply this to our lives so far? If you're not hearing from God, if you feel like your prayers are just kind of going nowhere, maybe they're the metaphor we've used, they're bouncing off the ceiling, they're just not, you feel like they're not getting beyond your words, they're just not going, making it to the throne, or God's not listening or whatever. Go back and ask, what's the last thing God said to you? What's the last thing God said? Go back in prayer journal and your thoughts and pray, ask God, what's the verse? What's the passage? What's the word that he gave you? The last thing that he said to you? Because here's the thing. The promise that God made here to Abram is unconditional. It doesn't depend on mankind's ability. It doesn't depend on our wit, on our wisdom. It is unconditional. All Abram has to do is believe and do what God says. And that sounds so easy, doesn't it? It may be simple, but it's not easy. Again, think of your own life. God may have called you to something simple to obey, simple to understand, not easy to obey. So Abram, it hears from God once again. He says, in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Not only was Abram promised blessing, but God also promised to make him a blessing. He's promised to be given blessing, but to make him a blessing, even to the point where all the families of the earth will be blessed. And again, this promise is fulfilled, we know, through Jesus. God's blessing to Abram was not for his own sake, or even for the sake of the Jewish nation to come. It was for the whole world. It says, all the families of the earth. The Apostle Paul put it this way when he wrote the letter to the church in Galatia. What's more, the scriptures look forward to the time when God would make the Gentiles right in his sight because of their faith. God proclaimed the good news to Abraham long ago when he said, all nations will be blessed through you. So all who put their faith in Christ share the same blessing that Abraham received because of his faith. That's from Galatians 3. So this means that whatever God is saying to Abraham, he is also saying to us as believers. We can truly look at this. We're New Testament Christians. I've heard that said, right? We're also Old Testament Christians. We can look at the Old Testament word and see that whatever God's saying to Abraham, that also can be applied to our lives. So continues. So Abram went forth as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. Now Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai and his wife and Lot his nephew, and their possessions which they had accumulated, and the persons which they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan as they came to the land of Canaan. Okay. God called him to leave his home and leave his family. Initially, he leaves, he lets his dad lead him. So he's not left his family, he's left his home. So he's kind of taking his home with him because he's still with dad. And then dad dies, and he says, I'm going to take nephew Lot with me. But Lot needs me. He can justify it, right? Abraham is making decisions based on his reasoning rather than on God's promise to him. He's looking at Lot and his needs rather than God's calling. Sometimes we make our decisions based on reasoning rather than God's word. We've heard God's word. We've gotten God's word. We see it before our eyes. We've heard it through prayer. And yet we make decisions based on our wisdom and what we think. We can't see the future. Abraham couldn't see the future. He couldn't understand why it would make sense to leave Lot behind. But God called him to do that. And we're going to see Lot's going to be trouble. And Abram's going to have a lot of grief. And Lot, and we'll see in coming chapters, that the problems that came through Lot ended up being enemies of Israel. And he should have left him behind as God told him. But again, God doesn't give up on him. He doesn't throw up his hands. His promise is unconditional in spite of Abram's disobedience. He continues. So, and Abram passed, verse 6, through the land as far as the site of Shechem to the oak of Moreh. Now the Canaanite was in the land. And the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land. So he built an altar there, underline the word altar, to the Lord who had appeared to him. And he proceeded from there to the mountain of the east of, underline Bethel, or Bethel, and pitched his tent, underline the word tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai, underline Ai, on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. Underline, highlight, put a star next to, called upon the name of the Lord. This is so significant what happens here. He is going, following the Lord. Yes, he's compromising. Yes, we see that he's not fully surrender the things that God told him to walk away from. He's brought Lot with him, but he is coming to a place and he's calling on the name of the Lord. Bethel means house of God. House of God. Ai means heap of ruins. Heap of ruins. Abraham is a picture of us. We are on our way to glory. He's on his way to Canaan. He's on his way to the promised land, as is Abraham. We are on our way to heaven. He also has heaven in mind, and he pitches his tent between the house of God and the heap of ruins. We have in our heart and in our minds the house of God. We have heavenly home on our minds. Meanwhile, the world is a heap of ruins. Yes, there's beautiful things in this world, but we know this world is passing away. This world is not our home. And we also pitch our tent between Bethel and Ai. We can relate to him. He pitched his tent. He didn't build a home of sticks or bricks. He built a home of a tent that was ready to move on right away. It was very, if you're taking notes, temporary. Very temporary was a tent. But he built an altar, and an altar is brick and mortar, stone and mortar. It is permanent. His lodging was temporary. His worship was permanent. In other words, his priorities were on heaven. His priorities were on the unseen. His priorities were on his heavenly home as he built his altar. He saw his heavenly home, his earthly home, as secondary, as very temporary. We tend to build our tents and pitch our altars. And what I mean by that is we tend to invest so much in this world and pour so much and have so much anxiety and concern and sweat equity in the things that are passing and pitch our altars and put the things of God secondary. Whenever something comes up, perhaps in our lives, and we think, okay, I got to prioritize, the things of God fall behind and fall into second place, maybe even are forgotten. Seeking the Lord, church attendance, giving to the ministry, and whatever there may be, we find ourselves compromising in that way. Abraham had his priorities right, and we can learn from him to pitch our tents and build our altars as he did. So Abraham, I believe, is growing. He's growing in his faith. Even though he is still going to make some decisions here in the next few verses, we're going to see that are not wise. He's growing in his faith. But he's still making some decisions based on circumstances over what God said to him. Verse 9, and Abram journeyed on, continuing toward the Negev. And you can picture over in Jerusalem, that sliver of land called Israel. You can see right in just picture in the center, and then go south there and you got the Negev. The Negev is that area between Israel and Egypt. And Egypt is south of the Mediterranean Sea. You can, from that perspective, you can go like this and go through the Negev to Egypt. Now there was a famine in the land. Look at verse 10. Do you see a semicolon between land and so? Now, in my Bible, there's a semicolon. Underline or highlight or circle that semicolon. That tells me that something's missing. Well, it's grammatically right. Yes, it's grammatically correct. But what's missing is, so Abraham prayed. He didn't pray. It says, now there's a famine in the land, so Abraham went. He didn't seek the Lord. He simply said, oh my goodness, there's a famine. I got to fulfill God's calling, so I need to get out of here, and I need to go to a place where there's food. Now, there was a famine in the land. So Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. Egypt always represents the world. Egypt is a picture, a type of the world. Abram is now making decisions, again, still making decisions, based on his circumstances over what God said. He didn't pray, he just went. Over in Isaiah 31, look what it says in verse 1 of Isaiah 31. Woe to those who go down to Egypt for help and rely on horses and trust in chariots because they are many. And in horsemen, because they are strong. But they do not look to the Holy One of Israel, nor seek the Lord. And I've got written out next to that, trust in the Lord and nothing else. It is easy when the heat gets turned up in our lives to go to the world for a relationship, for finances, to even succumb to the ways of the world. And deception and unethical and compromise in our own standards and godly standards rather than trusting the Lord and to say, I'm going to compromise here because I need to do this. I got to feed my family. I got to succeed. I know I can make it this way. It may be, again, in relationships where there could be a godly young man or woman who's been in church growing in the Lord and just is tired of waiting on the Lord to bring that person. And they say, I'm going to go back to the world. I'm going to go to the club, go to the hangout, go to the wherever, and find that person for me. That's like going down to Egypt, and it will always end in disaster. Seek the Lord. He's faithful. Pray. He will take care of you. Trust in Him with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, meaning all your paths and all your decisions, acknowledge Him, and He will make you keep your paths straight. So Abraham now goes from a little rough to worse. The father of faith now is going to have an even greater struggle. Verse 11, and it came about when he came near to Egypt that he said to Sarai, his wife, see now, I know that you are a beautiful woman. So he starts out really well, doesn't he? He's starting out right on. Good job, Abram. And it will come about when the Egyptians see you that they will kill me, but they will let you live. Now look at what he says there again. That well, they will say, this is his wife, and they will kill, underline, me, but they will let you live. Please say that you are my sister, underline my sister, so that it may go well with me because of you, and that I may live on account of you. Now, in my opinion, in my humble opinion, I think Abraham's kind of being a jerk here. Get an amen? Yeah. He's not putting her first. He's not trusting in the Lord. He's trusting in his own wisdom. Now, in ancient Near Eastern culture, it's true that if someone, a royalty, wanted a wife of someone or whatever, they would kill the husband and take the wife. And so it was a legitimate concern he has, but what's he trusting in? He's trusting in his own reasoning rather than in the word God gave him. Twice, God's given him that word, right? So he's not really trusting in the Lord. So Sarai was very beautiful. There's a Jewish legend that says, now again, this is not scripture. This is a Jewish legend that says this. When Abram went down into Egypt, he tried to hide Sarai in a box. When Egyptian customs officials asked what he had in the box, he said, barley. They said, no, it contains wheat. Abram said, very well, I'll pay the custom on wheat. Then the officers said it contained pepper, which is more expensive apparently than a box full of barley or wheat. And Abram said he would pay the custom charges on pepper. Then the officers said it contained gold. Abram said he would pay the custom charges on gold. Then they said it contained precious stones. By this time, the officers insisted on opening the box because Abram even said he would pay the custom charges on the precious stones. When they did, all of Egypt shined with the beauty of Sarai. These same Jewish legends say that Sarai was even more beautiful than Eve. Abram says, in wanting to protect his wife and himself, he said, she's my sister. Now, if you take it to another level, again, in that culture, I told you what would happen if they knew that they were married. But if he went in and said, she's my sister, which by the way, they were related as half brother, half sister. So it wasn't a full lie, just a half lie. And so, which still doesn't make it right, right? And so they would negotiate a dowry. And they would say, okay, since you are her brother, let's talk about a dowry negotiation. How much do I need to pay you, Abram, for your sister? Apparently, Abram's a good negotiator because they left with a whole lot of wealth afterwards, even though they're going to find out that they were married. But think about Sarah. And I wonder in her mind, we don't know because it's not here, but we can just imagine. I wonder if she was thinking, okay, this isn't bad. I'm living in a palace rather than a tent. I've had baths every day. I haven't had a bath in months. I've been living in, you know, And we don't know if what the pharaoh looked like may have been handsome. Most of the scholars that I've read said he looked a lot like Yul Brynner, but I don't know, that can't be verified. And if you don't know the movie, you'd have to just look and look it up. But but the fact is that we don't know. But I'm just curious. I wonder if she thought this isn't too bad. And maybe she was tempted to say, Abram, you made the right decision. I doubt it. Just a thought. So, Abram has not arrived, has he? He's still making decisions that are unwise and going against what God's called him to. Verse 14, and it came about when Abram came into Egypt, the Egyptians saw that the woman was very beautiful. And Pharaoh's officials saw her and praised her to the Pharaoh, and the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. Therefore, he treated Abraham well for her sake and gave him sheep and oxen and donkeys and male and female servants and female donkeys and camels, a good negotiator. And the Lord struck Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abram's wife. Then Pharaoh called Abram and said, What is this you've done to me? Why did you not tell me that she is your wife? Why did you say she's your sister? She's my sister, so that I took her for my wife. Now then, here's your wife. Take her and go. And amazingly, look what God does for Abram and Sarai. Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, and they escorted him away with his wife and all that belonged to him. They didn't send him away empty-handed. They didn't take away the dowries. God compelled the Pharaoh to enrich Abram even beyond his current wealth. God's children are going to be taken care of. In spite of how we may miss it and delay things because of our own compromise, God has taken care. Back in verse 16, therefore he treated Abram well for her sake. God blessed and protected Abraham even when he didn't do right. That's not to say go out and do wrong. That's, again, Paul addresses that in Romans, doesn't he? That's not to say, well, then we should just go out and have our way. And no. That's to say when we have faltering in our faith, the Lord is still faithful. Here's the point. God did not withdraw his promise because the promise depended on God. It's a covenant. God did not withdraw his promise because the promise depended on God. Abram goes into this situation, this challenge to his faith. Please say that you're my sister. Again, this was a half-truth, which is also a half-lie. Abram's intent was clearly to deceive. He trusted in his deception to protect himself instead of trusting in the Lord. Listen, if we want to do something wrong bad enough, we can find some good reasons to do it. We can talk ourselves into doing wrong. We can talk ourselves into that ethical or moral compromise. Here's what Abram could have said. In faith, he could have said, Look, God promised me children, and I don't have them yet. Therefore, I know that I am indestructible until God's promise is fulfilled, because God's promises are always true. God will protect me and my wife Sarai. That's what he could have said. That is not what he said. Perhaps that's what he would have said years later when he had a greater faith. But at this point, circumstances are allowing his faith to grow stronger. And in our lives, God does the same thing. He puts us through things so that our faith will grow. If we didn't have the challenges, we wouldn't grow in faith. So God blesses Abram even when he didn't do what he should. God continued to protect Abram, even when Abram acted like a liar. God did not call back his promise to Abram because the promise depended on God, not on Abram. He, the king, the Pharaoh, says, What's this you've done to me? So now this pagan king is rebuking Abram. God's divine protection of Abram and Sarai shows that if he would have trusted in God and told the truth, everything would have been all right. God is growing Abram into a man of great faith. He's growing you and me into people of faith. But this does require circumstances. Where Abram must trust God, we have circumstances where we must trust God. It's been said that faith is not a mushroom that grows overnight in damp soil. It also grows in other stuff, as it grows in that stuff too. Yes, true. It does take stuff to help faith grow. But it's been said that it's an oak tree that grows over time under the blast of wind and rain. So Abe is growing. Abram, before we get into chapter 13, just the first few verses and we'll wrap it up. Abram has blown his testimony to this pagan king. He's blown his testimony. But God is not done with him. Some of us in our lives have blown our testimony, but God was not done with us. We've blown it too. But God doesn't kick us to the curb. God never gives up on Abraham, and he never gives up on you and me. So Abram, watch what he does. Went up from Egypt. So he's going north. Again, kind of around the coast of the Mediterranean, up through from Egypt, up through from the south, back into Israel, into Palestine, into Canaan, as it's called then. Went up from Egypt to the Negev, he and his wife and all that belonged to him, and Lot with him. Now, Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver, and in gold, because God had enriched him through the Pharaoh. And he went on his journey from the Negev as far as Bethel. Where'd he go to? Bethel. Underline that. He went back to Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning. Between Bethel and Ai, the same place. He goes back to the same place, to the place of the altar, underline in verse 4, altar, which he had made there formerly. And there, you see a familiar phrase we saw in chapter 12, verse 8, Abram called on the name of the Lord. He calls on the name of the Lord. What happened? Abram goes back to Bethel, which was the place where God was working in his life before all this happened. He goes back to that place to seek God again. We don't know what he said. We don't know about that conversation, but we know that he's a different person when he's gone back. He's changed. He's grown. So what are some lessons that God wants to teach us through this account of Abram? One, God is not surprised by the famine. God has promised us, he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete that work that he's begun. He's not surprised when a famine comes. Don't freak out. He's got you. He's not going to give up on you, and he's not going to abandon you. He's got you. That's number one. Number two, famines can't block God's blessings. Famines can't block God's blessings. He's not surprised by the famine, and they can't block his blessings. But famines teach us this. Where God guides, God provides. Famines, and again, an economic famine, a health famine, a emotional famine, a political famine, whatever you want to call it. They teach us that where God guides, God provides. God grows our faith by placing us in situations in which we have nothing else we can do but to trust the Lord. That's what we have to do when we're placed in that situation, which we have the opportunity to do. So God isn't surprised by the famines. Famines can't block God's blessings. Famines teach us that where God guides, God provides. And then Abraham's decision reveals that, like many, he believes in God, but doesn't actually believe God. He is a believer in that he believes in God. But is he walking out that faith in his everyday circumstances, in his everyday challenges to his faith? He's not fully yet. He's the father of faith, but he didn't start out that way. God said in verse 2, I will bless you, and many other I wills, right? So he believes in God, but doesn't really believe him. So what we see in Abraham's life is that small compromise leads to big compromise. If we're compromising him in small things, we're going to compromise in big things. God told him, follow me. Abram followed his dad. God said, leave your relatives. Abram brought Lot. God leads him to the promised land, but he leaves the promised land when the famine hits. And he goes down to Egypt and he asks his wife to lie to save his own skin. Abram goes down into Egypt as a believer, and he is tried there. He comes back to the land of promise, spiritual. He's now true. He goes down and is tried. He comes back true, tried and true. He goes down a believer. He comes back spiritual, meaning dying more to self, truly living in the tent, truly going to the altar. I love verse 4 in chapter 13 because he went back to that place. And I think he had a conversation with God and he got some things straightened out. He said, God, just guessing, thank you that you didn't abandon me. Thank you that you're never going to give up on me. I've sinned against you. And some of us may have found ourselves in a similar situation. God is saying, I'm here. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'll restore you. Remember, Isaiah 30, verse 18, he's sitting on the edge of his seat. The Lord longs to be gracious to you. He waits to have compassion on you. The Lord is a God of mercy. He's a God of justice. How blessed are all those who long for him. He says, I will, I will, I will, to us as well. And all these promises are yes and amen. Our part is to say, I will back. I will lift you high in the lowest valley. I will bless your name. I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my days, oh yes, I will. So I want to pray, and then we're going to finish with that song, Yes, I Will. And just make that your prayer to the Lord. No matter where you find yourself today, I encourage you to go back to your Bethel, to that place of worship in your prayer closet before the Lord. Be honest with him. Say, Lord, thank you for the reminder that you accept me. And you have a covenant relationship with me too. And you're going to make sure I make it. So when I blow it, Lord, and I've blown it, wherever you are today, go to him and make that right. Lord, we thank you for your word. And now, Lord, in worship, we acknowledge you are good. And our part is to lift you up and to trust in you and to draw close in faith. And the circumstances, Lord, don't catch you by surprise. In fact, you designed them so that we grow. And we thank you for Abraham and the witness that he is to us. Grant us the grace as well to grow in our relationship with you, and that our faith would grow strong no matter what. Through Jesus we pray. Amen.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is
working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.